members has start our last and very important session, section 195 form 15CA and 15CM. We have with us two speakers, CA Kota Srinivas and CA Vinay Shetty. I request again, sir, please come forward and Scott and our speakers and present a welcome book. The both speakers.
My friend and colleague, Sri Vinay Sanjay will be taking you through this practical aspects of 15C and 15CE. Before going to section 195, after knowing most of the aspects of international taxation, now we are discussing about TDS, tax deduction at source. Section 4 is a charging section of the Income Tax Act, where 4.1 says so any SSE who is liable to be charged in the Income Tax Act will be subject to tax as per section 4. With your permission, I will not be going through the slides. Anytime if I get stuck, I will go back to the slides, otherwise I will not go to the slides. It's okay with you people?
Yes.
Okay. So section 4 is charging section 4.1, which says that any SSE who is liable to be charged to tax under the provisions of the Income Tax Act, it will be subject to taxation under section 4.1. When we say that section 4.1 is a charging section, then how to collect the taxes? What are the modes of collection of taxes? 4 subsection 2 talks about the modes of collection of taxes, where they say two modes of taxation, that is, one is the form of advance tax and the other one is tax deduction at source or tax collection at source. Of course, apart from this, we even have self-assessment tax, but mainly this collection and recovery of tax relates with with respect to this advance tax and TDS. And even if you see the tax collections, last year we have collected around 10 lakh crores in Income Tax Act. So 80 to 85% will come in the form of TDS and advance tax. The balance percentage only comes in self-assessment tax, and it's very negligible amount, I should say. So 4.2 says the mode of recovery of tax is advance tax and self-assessment tax. And there is a separate chapter 17, which deals with collection and recovery of taxes. So it starts with section 190 and ends it 234F. Recently 234F has been introduced, where from this year it will be applicable. If you don't file the return of income before July 31st, there's a penalty. So 190 to 234F deals with collection and recovery of taxes. So section 190 says that any SSE who is any person who is supposed to make payment, and as per the provisions of the Income Tax Act, if he has to deduct TDS, he is subject to deduct TDS. Then 191 section says that even though there is a specific provision that a person, a payer, has to deduct tax, suppose if he is not deducting tax, or he after deducting if he is not remitting, the ultimate liability is in the SSE. So the SSE cannot keep quiet that somebody is going to deduct and is remitting, so you cannot relax. So section 191 says the ultimate liability of paying the tax will be that of SSE. And as we know, this TDS is a surrogate tax where it is deducted on behalf of one person and remitted on behalf of the person to the government. Then section 192 to 193 talks about the various provisions of even 194. Talks about various deductions, and most of it covers this payments to residents. Then 195 is other sums, which is dealing directly with non-resident payments. So when we talk about tax deduction at source, these are the sections. 195 deals with payments to non-residents. When we talk about tax deduction at source, what are all the activities that a payer has to do? So there are 4 activities a person has to do for with respect to the TDS. One is deducting tax at source. The second one is remitting the tax whatever that has been deducted. Third one is filing the return of income, quarterly return of income. The fourth one is issuing the TDS certificate for whatever the tax deducted and remitted on behalf of the payee. So these are all the 4 activities a payer has to do with respect to tax deduction at source. Now, before going to section 195, if I have to tell you the similarities and dissimilarities between TDS provisions with respect to the residents and non-residents, that is payments to residents, payments to non-residents, let me just bring before you a few of the similarities and dissimilarities also. When I talk about similarities, whatever I said, these 4 procedures, whether payer is making payment to resident or non-resident, it is same. So even if you are making a remittance to non-residents, you have to deduct, you have to remit, you have to file the return and you have to issue form 16A. So whatever the returns that you are filing, that is quarterly return, the form of the return may change for residents and for non-residents, but the procedures are same. Then even the due date, when we talk about the due dates for remittance of TDS, with respect to residents and non-residents is same. So as all of us are aware, so whatever the tax deducted in a particular month should be remitted within 7th of the subsequent month, except in the case of the month of March, where it will be has to be remitted by 30th of April. So even remittance, there is a similarity between residents and resident payments and non-resident payments. When it comes to the rate of tax, so when you see all these sections for residents, so most of the sections, if you see, the rate is specified in the section. So if you say 194C, the rate should be specified, 194I, the rate should be specified, 194H, most of the sections for resident payments, the rates are specified in the Act itself. But when you see 195, the rates are not specified in the that section, but to go back to the Finance Act. So the rates are not specified. Then coming to the disallowance, say if a person who is supposed to make payment and if he has not deducted, so what is the disallowance under section 40A? With respect to the residents, whatever the amount that is not subject to TDS, in case of resident payments, it will be, what will be the disallowance? 30% of the amount will be disallowed. But when it comes to non-resident payments, 100% will be disallowed. So 100% of the amount will be disallowed in case of non-resident payments. And when it comes to resident payments, only 30% will be disallowed. And one more dissimilarity, I should say, is in most of the resident cases where the payments are made, there are certain threshold limits. Each and every section specifies certain threshold limits. Say for 194C, there is a threshold limit, 194J, 194I. For everything, there is a threshold limit. Exceeding that limit, they are subject to TDS. But when it comes to non-resident payments, there are no threshold limits. Right from rupee 1, it is subject to TDS. Then finally, this assessee in default. So section 201, which talks about assessee in default. In case of resident payments, if the recipient, that is the person who receives the, who is supposed to subject to TDS, say the person who is making the payment has not made the TDS, and the resident files the return of income considering this particular income and also showing that filing his return of income, considering this income and paying the whatever the necessary taxes, the person who is supposed to do TDS is not considered as a same default if the payment is made to a resident. But the same provisions is not applicable for a payment made to a non-resident. Even though the non-resident has filed his income, even though the non-resident has considered this income in his return of income, even though the non-resident has paid the applicable taxes, even then, the person who is supposed to deduct TDS is considered as assessee in default. So these are some of the, I should say, the similarities and dissimilarities compared to this what is called as resident TDS, TDS with respect to resident payments and TDS with respect to non-resident payments. Whatever I said is not there in the material. If you are searching, it will not be there because those things are not there in the slides. Then coming to the provisions of section 195, I'll just show. This is the overview of section 195. We have 7 subsections in section 195. 195.1 talks about scope and conditions for applicability. 195.2 talks about application by payer for lower withholding certificate. Then 195.3 application by payee for nil withholding certificate. 195.4 and 5 talks about some procedural aspects. 195.6 is important where payer shall furnish certain information, and 195.7 also is some procedural things. Let us try to understand this important section, that is 195.1 and 195.6. Of course, 195.6 is the section where it talks about furnishing of information. The person who is supposed to make remittance has to furnish two forms. One is as a chartered accountant, their payer has to furnish two things. One is 15 CA and 15 CB wherever it is applicable. Then there is one word called withholding of taxes. How many of you have heard about it? I think all of you would have, most of you would have heard about it. There is a word called tax deduction at source. Is there any difference between tax deducted at source and withholding of taxes? Do we see any difference in means the meaning of it, or is it a general word in Indian Income Tax Act? We use tax deduction at source. Some foreign local laws may use withholding tax. Is there any difference between these two terminology? Tax deducted at source and withholding of taxes. So generally for estate payments you say tax deducted source. For 195 you say withholding of tax. Okay. Why the difference? What is there any difference between these?
Domestic payments and foreign payments.
So you are saying it is for domestic payments TDS, foreign payments withholding.
Because for the domestic payments it's already a source wherein the tax is deducted and then paid to the government.
Okay.
But withholding means for the payments. So here it's an income, that's a payment.
Yeah, I think that's near to what I am thinking.
So, in TDS, it is only in the form of a advance collection of tax before the final assessment. That is applicable to residents. In the case of non-resident, withholding tax is something like a full and final. So,
that's what
there is no further assessment for them.
Correct. So, the terminology is same, meaning is same, both are same means, withholding tax or tax deduction at source, it's both are collection at source only. But as we just go into detail, or if you want to, like, what is the difference between accrual and arising? So there may be a very slight thin difference between these two English words. So here what I said, that's what I wanted to say. Tax deduction at source, in most of the cases, it's as he said, an advance or like in 194C, we deduct at 2% or 1%. That is not the rate of tax. But when it comes to non-residents, we call it as withholding of tax, where we try to withhold the entire tax amount. Say, in case of royalty payments or fees for technical services, that the taxation rate is 10%. So we withhold the entire 10% as per the Income Tax Act. So the entire tax liability has been withheld. So withholding of tax, tax deduction at source. So this is a slight difference, I can say, between TDS and WHT. And why payments withholding is very important with respect to non-residents compared to residents. So why it is very, very important for a payer to withhold the tax in case of non-residents? Because it's very difficult for the department to have a control on that non-resident. Because residents, they are in India, so anytime they can go and demand the tax amount. But with respect to the non-resident, and once the payment has gone, it's very difficult to recover. So there is an emphasis that entire tax has to be recovered from the non-resident. Then moving on to section 195, scope and conditions for applicability. The section 195 reads as follows. Any person responsible for making payment to non-residents, not being a company or foreign company, by way of interest, other than interest in section 194LB, 194LC and 194LD, or such other sum chargeable under the provisions of this Act, shall, at the time of credit to the account of the payee, or payment by way of cash, or by way of bank, or by way of check, or any other mode, deduct tax thereon at the rates or rates in force. So this is what I should say, the sum and substance of section 195 or the text of section 195.1. So it talks about the scope and applicability of TDS provisions. Now let us try to understand each and every word or each and every segment in this. Then we will definitely understand more into the section 195. So it starts with any person responsible for making payment to a non-resident, not being a company or a foreign company. So any person, so person is defined under section 2, subsection 31. So all the seven persons, all the seven types of persons who were being defined under section 231, if they make payment to a non-resident, then section 195 is applicable. Then any person responsible for making payment. So section 204 defines person responsible for making payment. So who is the person responsible for making payment is defined in section 204 of the Income Tax Act. So in case of all the seven persons what we have, anybody who is paying like individual HA firm or association of persons, they are the persons who are responsible for making the payment. In case of company, the company and the principal officer is responsible for making payment to a non-resident. Then any person responsible for making payment to a non-resident, not being a company or a foreign company. So who is a non-resident? So non-resident is defined under section, residential status is defined under section 6 of the Income Tax Act. So we have to go through that residential status. And recently there was an amendment in section 6, subsection 3, where the concept of POEM has come in. So we should ensure that there is no place of effective management with respect to a foreign company, so that if there is a place of effective management of a foreign company in India, then it will become a resident as per section 6. So as per section 6, a company which has got a place of effective management, a foreign company, that will become a resident company in India. Based on OEM, if a company, foreign company becomes a resident, what provisions has to be applied? Whether we have to apply general provisions or should we apply 195 provisions? Based on the applicability of OEM, say suppose if a foreign company becomes a resident company, whether the regular provisions should be applicable or 195 should be applicable? Even I don't know the answer, I want an answer from you. Which one should be applicable? Because based on, it's a foreign company as per section 195, but as per 6.3, because of POEM applicability, it will become resident. So which provision should I apply? 195 or 192 provisions? Because it is a resident company.
Any person to non-resident?
Sir?
Section 195 word says, any person to non-resident.
Yes, it is not a non-resident. Now it has become a resident because of OEM.
Sir, all permits in India produce has to be current income tax provision.
No, whether it is Indian group, the currency will not decide whether it is a payment to a resident or non-resident. If it is a payment to a non-resident, 195 will apply. Now, here is a case where a foreign company is a non-resident, but because of applicability of OEM, it has become resident. Should I apply 195 or other sections?
195.
So, like, as section 6 says, which is a resident company, it says Indian company, and because of OEM, a foreign company will become a resident. But when once you see the definition of foreign company, section 195 says foreign company. Now, non-resident not being a company or a foreign company. And if you go to the definition of foreign company under section 2, I don't remember subsection, there is a definition of foreign company which says it is a company which is not a domestic company. So as per that, I feel still we should go with the 195 provisions. Even though because of the applicability of OEM, foreign company has become a resident company, still it being a foreign company, we should go on to the province of section 195. While deducting TDS, okay, maybe when afterwards I will come to that. So I was telling you about payment made to a non-resident, not to a company or to a foreign company. What payment we have to make? Two things have been defined. One is the interest payment. The second one is any sum charged under the provisions of this Act. So interest payment, there they have excluded three types of interest, that is interest paid under section 194 LB, under 194 LC, and 194 LD, where there is a specific provisions and it is 5% TDS on those three provisions. So any sum by way of interest or such other sum chargeable under the provisions of this Act. So when once we see such other some chargeable provision of this act, how to determine what is the chargeable provision of this act, then again you have to go back to section 5, which talks about the scope of income. And what is income chargeable under the provisions of this act? Of course, we have to go to 224, which defines the income. But to make it simple, let me go to section 14, which talks about the heads of income. So we have 5 heads of income, that is income from salary, house property, business and profession, capital gains and other sources. So whenever there is a payment to a non-resident, and if you see that it is chargeable under the provisions of, or it is coming under any of these heads of income, then it is some charge under the provisions of this act. Clear? It is some charge under the provisions of this act. So, well, if you see this, if whatever the payment it is coming under any of these 5 heads of income, then it is subject to taxation under section 195. But here there is one exception. Any payment made to a non-resident in the form of salaries, any payment made to a non-resident in the form of salary still comes under section 192. It will not come to 195. So excluding income from salary, income from house property, business or profession, capital gains and other sources, everything is subject to taxation under section 195.
Sir, here the word used is to a non-resident not being a company. So means yeah. If we are paying any foreign company, then we need not deduct.
No, yeah. Non-resident not being a company, comma, a foreign company. So, not being a company means other associates, then foreign company. A non-resident not being a foreign company, comma, a foreign company. Then, the definition of non-resident is defined, given in section 2, subsection 30. So, there, for section 195, resident but not ordinary resident will not form, means will not be considered as a non-resident. So, it is applicable only for non-residents. A resident but not ordinary resident will not be forming part of section 195. So you should see, if the payment is made only to a non-resident, section 195 will apply. Then apart from this salary, even dividends paid under dividends which has been paid and which has suffered taxation under section 115O is also not subject to taxation, because the dividend which has been paid has suffered a tax in the hands of the company. The recipient is not subject to taxation. So whether it is a resident individual or non-resident, so dividend is not subject to taxation. So there is no need for going into this section 195. And then when the taxes has to be deducted, of course that is similar to what we have the provisions with respect to the residents, at the time of credit to the account of the payee or by way of payment, whichever is earlier. So account of payee, they say that it need not be, means even if you are crediting to the that particular person's account, or you credit in the form of a suspense account or any other name, that is construed as accredited to that particular account. And by way of payment, by cash or by way of check or any other mode, whichever is earlier, they are supposed to deduct tax and so. In certain case of payments, like where the central government is paying, or public sector banks are paying, or public financial institutions are paying interest to the non-residents, then it is not on the on the basis of credit, it's only on the basis of payment, actual payment. So it's an exception to this rule, where the central government or public sector bank or public financial institutions are paying interest to the non-resident, the TDS applicability is only on actual payment, not on the credits. So if any non-resident is having any what we call the fixed deposits, and it will be maturing, on maturity it will be there. So every year they will be creating interest. So even though it is subject to taxation, the TDS provision need not be done every year. Only an actual payment of interest, that TDS has to be done. But this will not apply for cooperative banks and foreign banks. It's only for public sector banks and government, payment by government. Then tax deduction at source at the rates or rates in force. So rates or rates in force is defined in section 2, subsection 37 and subclause 3 for section 195. So as I said, for most of the sections in resident clauses, there is a rate, but in 195, it's rates or rates in force. So if you go to 237A, rates or rates in force, it gives two rates. So whichever is beneficial as per section 90, SSE can apply. So one rate is just been defined in the relevant finance act. So if you go to the finance act, schedule 3 will give all the TDS rates for that particular type of income or the relevant DTA. So you have to compare the DTA rates between India and the country where the transaction is happening. Then the rate as per the finance act, whichever is beneficial to the SSE, that the payer itself can decide whichever is beneficial and accordingly it can do the tax deduction and source. So this is section 195, which says that a payment made by any person, payment made to a non-resident, either at the time of credit or actual payment, shall deduct tax at source at the rates or rates in force. And the type, nature of payment is any interest or such other sum charged under the provisions of this act, excluding income from salary and dividend. So it says such other sum, so on the gross amount usually we will deduct TDS. We cannot calculate the actual income and we'll do. Whenever the payment is made to a non-resident, usually we make at the TDS on the gross amount. So to, when we see the applicability of section 195, if resident is making a payment to a resident, section 195 is not applicable. If resident is making a payment to a non-resident, section 195 is applicable. If non-resident is making payment to a resident, section 195 is not applicable. If non-resident is making payment to a non-resident, section 195 is applicable. So how, which are the circumstances where non-resident making payment to non-resident? I think yesterday you would have seen section 9. To interest, royalty and FTS, he explained that any payment made by government or resident or non-resident to non-resident is subject to taxation. So only based on the recipient being a non-resident, this section 195 is applicable. So this is the sum and substance of section 195. So even 195, there was a provisions explanation that was introduced recently, like similar to that section 9-2 provisions, where they say whether non-resident has got a place of residence, a place of business, or a business connectivity, or he has presence in whatsoever manner, whether or not, but he is subject to TDS. So we will not see whether that non-resident has got a presence in this country or whether he has rendered services through India. So all those things are not there. That was not required in 190, but they have introduced to clarify the doubts, all those things, they have introduced that also. Any doubts in 195? So this is 195-1. So this is the TDS provisions under section 195-1. Then we'll go to other provisions, that is 195-2. So 195-2 talks about application by payer for lower authority certificate. So usually in the resident payments, the recipient can approach the income tax department and file an application for lower or nil reduction of TDS. But under this 195-2 provides a provision where the payer can approach the income tax department. The reason being non-resident may not be in India to go and do all these things. So the payer, if he feels that whatever the sum that he is going to make payment to the pay, entire thing is not subject to taxation. For example, if I want to give an example, if a non-resident has sold a property to a resident, so whatever the sale proceeds may not be subject to capital gains tax. So there are certain deductions in Indian Income Tax Act where it is, like there may be deduction towards expenses incurred, or there will be deduction towards the cost of acquisition, there will be deduction towards cost of improvement. So net amount only will be subject to taxation, and so the payer, he may feel that entire amount, because in under section 195, you are supposed to deduct tax on the gross amount. So even when once you are making payment or you are buying a property, the resident is buying a property from non-resident, on the sale proceeds you are supposed to deduct TDS, the entire sale proceeds. Until and unless you go and obtain a certificate from the department stating that the entire amount is not subject to taxation, only this amount is, only a portion of this amount is subject to taxation. So under 195-2, the payer himself can approach the assessing officer and say this out of this total amount, only a portion of this amount is subject to taxation in India. So you give me permission to deduct tax on only this portion, not on the entire portion. So if suppose the payer approaches and assessing officer feels yes, whatever he is submitting is proper, then he will give a certificate on an order saying, stating that this is the portion of total sum. Out of total sum, this is the portion which is subject to taxation. On that, he can deduct the TDS. Otherwise, on the whole amount, he has to deduct TDS on 20.6%. Maybe now with 4% surcharge, 20.8% he has to deduct. So, under 195.2, a payer can approach the assessing officer. Then 195.3, the payee can approach the assessing officer. In 195.2, the payer will approach. In 195.3, a non-resident can, or the payer recipient, can approach the assessing officer. And usually in 195.3, they will approach for nil withholding tax. Means entire amount what he is receiving should not be subject to taxation. So entire amount should not be subject to taxation. So they will approach the assessing officer where it should be nil reduction of TDS. Similar to residents, there is a section 197 where the non-resident can approach the department where it can be for nil rate of TDS or reduced rate of TDS. So for non-resident, there are two sections. One is 195.3 and 194.7. Where in 195.3 usually they will go for nil withholding of taxation. In 197 they can go either for nil withholding or a reduced rate of TDS. 195.4 says what is the valid period of certificate that has been issued under 195.3. So whenever a assessing officer issues a certificate, the validity period will be there. Say for the one financial year, or if he withdraws that in between, that will be the due date. And 195.5 says power of the CBDT to issue notification. So it's not that the department will encourage each and every non-resident to apply at 195.3. So that there are certain conditions where that particular non-resident should have some existence in this country. Say like we should be doing business for last 4 or 5 years. You should have this minimum turnover, you should have minimum assets, and you should have been regularly filing his return of income, and you should have been filing his returns within the due dates, and there should not be any penalties or there should not be any assessments pending. All those certain conditions are there where the department will means allow such non-residents to apply under 195.3. So those conditions will be given in 195.5. And then 195.7 says assessing officer to determine appropriate proportion of sum charge. That's what I said in 195.2. Apart from this, if the board feels a certain class of persons or type of income, if they feel that the entire amount is not subject to taxation, by time and again they can issue notification and say that out of this only a proportion of sum is subject to taxation, and they can issue certificates for the lower reduction. Then there is section 195.6, which is a section which we talk about the duties or responsibilities of the person making the TDS. So any resident or non-resident who is making the TDS in the section 195, what he is supposed to do is defined under section 195.6. There are two things. One is he has to file the information in form 15CA, and then if wherever it is required, he has to collect a certification from a chartered accountant in form 15CB. So which are all the cases where 15CA is required, which are all the cases where 15CB is required, because Vinay will take us through in detail and all those things. Then we have this thing called 195A, which talks about grossing up of taxation. Grossing up of taxation, where a non-resident dealing with a resident, he says that I'm not worried about your local taxes. Whatever rate you want, you deduct. Means whatever rate is there, I am not worried about that. So my contract with you is, I have to get this much. Resident says, no, as per the Indian Act or Indian local laws, we have to deduct this much. The non-resident says, I am not aware of all your taxes, I want this much. Then in those cases, there is a section called 195A where you have to gross up the amount that has to be paid. So whatever amount you pay, you have to cross up with the taxes, and that will be the total amount minus TDS. You have to make remittance to the non-resident. Say suppose you are supposed to deduct TDS at 10%, and you are supposed to make payment to a non-resident of 100. So you should consider 100 as 90, and it has to be crossed up. So it will go as 111.11. On that 10% will come 11.11. If you deduct 111.11 minus 11.11, you will get 100. So that is what you are supposed to remit to the non-resident. So that crossing of provisions is also mentioned in section 195A. Then we have this 216AA, which talks about requirement of furnishing permanent account number. So this was there introduced, and there was certain amendments also in this particular section, where a non-resident is supposed to furnish a PAN number for getting a reduced rate of taxation. Earlier we had a provisions where we were deducting at the rate of 20%. So the 216A says if a person, the deductee, if he is not furnishing PAN, it should be highest of the following rates. One is the rates as per the relevant finance act, or the rates as specified in that particular section, or 20%, whichever is higher. So when it comes to resident payments, the rates are specified in that particular section, provisions of the income tax act. But when it comes to non-resident, you have to go back to the rates or rates in force, whichever is applicable, either as per the income tax act or DTA rate, either of the one you should have taken, plus 20% has to be compared. So we used to compare that, because 20% is higher, we used to charge at 20%. So any non-resident not issuing, giving us a PAN number, we were deducting tax at 20%. Then when it comes to income tax rate, you have to add surcharge incess. When it comes to DTA rate, you need not add surcharge incess. So whatever DTA rate is there, that is inclusive of all types of surcharge incess. So when once it comes to income tax rate, you have to add applicable surcharge incess. So when it comes to 216AA, that is also income tax rate, whether we have to add surcharge incess was the question. So we were not adding surcharge incess for 216AA, that is 50%, because if you go to the income tax app, if you go to the schedule 2-3, there it says on what sections you have to add surcharge, on what sections you have to add cess. So there 216AA is not mentioned. So that was one of the reasons why we were not taking. And other reasons also, other contention was it's a penalty rate, so you need not charge surcharge incess. That includes everything. So whenever you apply income tax rate, you have to add that with surcharge incess. When you are making a payment under DTA, you have to take that rate, which will be all inclusive. So whenever you are comparing the rates between DTA rate and local rate, income tax rate, you have to add surcharge incess, and then you have to compare with the DTA rate. So now with the surcharge incess, I think if it is 10%, 115A is 10%, plus surcharge 5%, 4, 4 and 6 is there. So it comes to 10.92%. 10.92% will be the income tax rate. So this has to be compared with the DTA rate. So most of the DTAs we have got 10%, few DTAs we have got 15%. So most of the, like where India does most of the trade, that is USA, then Australia, then maybe UK, all those things are at 15%. This Singapore, Netherlands, Ireland, all those things are 10%. So whenever you are comparing this 10.92 with the DTA rate, if it is DTA rate is 10% and 10.92, should go for 10%, and this is 15% means income tax rate of 10.92 we can adopt.
Excuse me.
Yeah.
So some of these payments where we clients are buying, purchasing over the online. Yes. So they're making purchases online. What are the TDS implications of that? I mean, would we say 195?
What
software down?
The software purchase is subject to taxation. General purchase is not.
Will it be 195A? It will have to be
double.
Because we don't have any dealings with them, we don't have their PAN, nothing.
So all the credit card purchases.
Credit card.
That's also subject to taxation. Practically it's difficult, but if you go by the law, all those things are subject to taxation. So SWA was saying. So this is what we were doing earlier. Then we gave, there was an amendment in section 90, subsection 4, where they came out with something called TRC, Tax Residency Certificate. So only when you have a Tax Residency Certificate, you are eligible to claim relief under the TTA. So again, there was a conflict. So earlier we were only asking whether you have PE or not, then we were asking whether you have got a PAN, then we started asking whether you have got TRC, then we started asking whether you have got a POEM. So one after the other documents we keep on asking. For making payment to a non-resident, so many things you have to ask. Earlier only whether you have got a PE or not, you used to ask. Then PAN, then TRC, now POEM also you have to ask. So this, if you don't have TRC, you cannot get into the DTA. For 94 says, until unless you have got a TRC, you cannot take relief under DTA. Then there is no question of comparison between local rate and DTA. So that is one thing. Then there was amendment in Rule 37 BC where for certain payments 206AA is not applicable. That is for interest, royalty, fees for technical services and capital gains. So for all these things, even if the non-resident is not providing a PAN, this 206AA is not applicable. So then again, we were asking everything and then again, PAN is not required now. So again, we have come back to with two or three documents. So all these changes keeps on happening. So every year we do basic on international taxation, one or two things keeps on adding. So it's better to keep on attending the basics on international taxation. This 195 to where you get a order from the department, it's a appealable order. But when you get an order certificate under 195.3 to 197, it's not appealable, whatever order you get accordingly you have to do it. This 40A1 visa is already said that in case of resident payments 30% will be deducted, in case of non-resident payments 100% will be disallowed. And as I see in default also I said, 206AA is already mentioned. So that's on BC. So this is a bird's eye view of section 195. When you have to determine the residential status, when a person making a payment has to determine the residential status of the recipient. So you are making payment on 1st of April, you are making payment on 1st of June, or you are making payment tomorrow, that is 30th of June. When you have to determine the residential status of a person, and in case of an SSC, when actually you determine the residential state of the person?
At the time of payment.
At the time of payment? No, actually for SSC, when you determine the residential status?
End of the year.
End of the year. So that is 31st of March. So we are determining the residential state of a person only by filing the return of income. But in past 364 days, there will be a lot of transactions. When a person is making payment to a person, another person, should he wait till the end of the year or he should determine the residence status at that particular point of time?
Beginning of the year.
Beginning of the year?
Okay.
Can change also.
Sir.
Payment to an overseas person.
To an overseas person.
To an overseas person.
Maybe till the end of the financial year,
is only the check if he could be treated as a resident. Otherwise, by default, he is a non-resident only.
So, now what I want to draw to means is, here is the point what I want to draw is, at the time of payment, the person who is supposed to make the payment, at that point of time, you determine his residential status, whatever it is. How you determine his left, whether it is you determine based on his opening means, as in first beginning of the year or some, or during the year, what is going to happen, you ascertain whether it is a resident or non-resident at that particular point of time. Because you cannot wait till the year and determine it. So, at the, if you determine his status on the date of payment, your liability is completed. So, you need not worry subsequently whether he will become resident. Resident may become non-resident, non-resident may become resident also. So, there may be a case where a person who is living in India from past, say, 50, 60 years, he dies in the month of June. June 2018, a person dies. He is staying in India for past 50, 60 years. 60 years of June. For the financial year 18-19, whether he is a resident or non-resident. Not June, sorry. In May, he will expire. A person expires on 28th of May 2018, who was in India for past 60 years. For the financial year 18-19, he will be resident or non-resident. As per section 6, he will be non-resident, less than 60 days, physical presence. He doesn't have even a passport or he has not even gone out of the state where he lives, assume. He doesn't have a passport also. He has not gone beyond his state or beyond his district. But Income Tax Act, he will become a non-resident.
That is actually better, sir. Not local income tax.
No, which I am saying practically, word by word, it will be a non-resident. But definitely there is something beyond law also. It will be considered as the resident only. So if you make payment to him on 30th of April, thinking that he will be a resident, after 1 week you will get a call that he has expired. So then you become non-resident. So all those things will be there. And in case of foreign companies, in the month of April, May, you will do some payments, considering it as a non-resident. But by year end, they will become a resident because of OEM. Of course, we said foreign companies, it is clearly mentioned 195, you will do it. Like that, there will be various circumstances. Or even a resident who can stay for up to less than 180 days and he can move out of India. So, a resident also can become non-resident. He can move out of India in the month of August or September, where he will be staying in India for less than 180 days. For that year, he will again become a non-resident. So, on the date of payment, if you determine his residential status, that will be sufficient for the person who is making the payment. So, this bird survey of section 195, payment to a non-resident, taxable under the Act, DTA not accessible, then deduct TDS and remit, DTA accessible, income not exempt under DTA, deduct tax, income exempt under DTA, no TDS, not taxable under the Act, no TDS, remittance of payment to non-resident. Any payment made to a non-resident or any payment in foreign currency, the banker will insist for certificate. Payment made to payment made to non-resident means it is going out of this country. The foreign exchange is going out of this country. Any outward remittance may be in foreign currency or Indian currency also. So if you may get a bill from a non-resident in Indian rupees also, but it's an outward remittance. So, outward remittance and a payment to a non-resident, section means bankers insist for certificate from a chartered accountant. So, as if you go through rule 37DB, there are a lot of exceptions where CA certificate is not required. In fact, actually, if you see today, like before this amendment and now after this amendment, maybe 80% of the cases you may not require a CA certificate now. 80% of the cases CA certificate is not required. Only what we were issuing earlier, if you apply this rule 37BB, probably 15-20% of the transactions only come under the ambit of issuing CA certificate. But for our luck, bankers are not understanding this. Most of the bankers were earlier we were saying Now we are saying here, we will not issue certificate, they are saying we want certificate. So only thing I can tell all my colleagues, professional colleagues, if bankers are existing, kindly issue certificate, but don't forget to issue your professional charges bill. Otherwise, you tell your client the certificate is not required, client comes and says, oh, there will be certificate, what pretty sir? What pretty sir, but bill raise money. So bill raise money is my certificate for everybody. And what is the charges you make for 15 CB? How many of you are issuing 15 CB? So, HR, what is 5,000. Next term? Are you paying it? Next, are you paying it? Somebody raised that who is issuing form 15 CB?
2,500,
okay. In the other room? 3,000. 2,500. So, all of you can, you got an idea that at least 2,500 to 5,000. Definitely, that requires that much of charges to be charged. Maybe you have to increase, madam, from 2,500 to. No, whatever it is. Of course, if you have a bulk form 15 CACP, then you can think of charging less. Otherwise, one-off cases, once in a while, it's coming, minimum 5,000 one has to charge. At least you have to recover this today's conference fees in one certificate. Otherwise, there is no use in attending and sitting till the last session. So, if you get form 15 CA, whatever amount you have paid, plus double of that, 5,000 minimum you should charge, plus GST. Don't say inclusive of GST, 5,000 again, you will lose 15-18% of that. So that is what you have to do it. So this is respect to this section 195, the basic law. The practical aspects, lot of things.
Sir, are we clear that equalization levy is paid, the tax rate is zero under 195? There's no TDS under.
Yeah, yeah, correct. That is 6%. The 10 subsection 50 is there, no? If equalization levy is there, it is not subject to taxation under the provisions of the income tax act. So even though it is taxable, 1050 is the exemption section for equalization levy. So there is no need for TDS or 195. So I hope I covered 195 all the aspects. If I remember anything, I'll just come and share with you afterwards. Thank you. Sir? Yes, sir, it is there, but practically I am also unable to charge that much.
Nobody is following.
Sir, it's only a recommended fee, sir. It's a recommended fee, but actually it's becoming very difficult. Of course, we have to discuss separately all these things because if you go to a doctor, any nursing home, if you go, the charges will be standard. Only in our profession, we are not, I don't know why we are able to maintain that. If you go to hot chips, how many of you eat chips here? How many of you don't eat chips? Or only that girl will eat chips. What is the rate, madam? For 100 grams of hot chips?
30
rupees, yeah. Entire Bangalore is 30 rupees.
Exactly.
I asked him, I just purchasing two places, I asked what is the same rate. He said, no, we have a union. Where for hot chips, wherever you go, entire Bangalore, it is 300 rupees per kilo, 100 grams is 30 rupees. Other items they can charge anything. So we don't have that, and if you people go for city market or market where during festivals, so flowers, vegetables, fruits, same rate. We don't have that consistency or standard for tax audits, how much we charge each of us, we know what we charge. So that's why institute has come out with minimum recommendation fees, but I personally feel that is too much, which is practically not possible. So we have to bring some means we should bring some practicality also, because we have been charging for past 70 years very small amount. Suddenly if you show that much, nobody will come, and it is so many times we feel we are charging so much for the client. That is what we feel. We pity the client so much, we are charging, even though we receive after 1 year. But sometimes when you want to make it big, you will feel that so much we are we charging so much. So that is our mentality. You can't to change it. Soft corners, yeah. And we cannot compare ourselves with other professions like doctor or not. Once you may go, lawyer once you may go. This is something, a relationship we will have or continue for many long years. So we cannot be very much stubborn on that, but at least we should have some standards where minimum fees we have to charge. But at least you charge 50% of the minimum fees or 75% of the minimum fees recommendation. So you can get really good returns. Thank you.
So coming to the last session, so basically much lighter session because most of the complicated provisions have been discussed, and the last part of it is only where we usually are able to bill. That is what we are trying to learn now. What exactly we need to basically do for implementing all these particular provisions. A fairly simple topic, and I will not take too much of your time in the last session, and I'll make it pretty fast. So my scope of presentation today will be on discussing the finer aspects of Form 15CA and 15CB, and what are some of the practical issues which we face, and maybe even you can come up with some situations you have faced so that we could collectively brainstorm that and find out some solutions here. So starting with when Form 15CA or 15CB has to be issued, there has to be some provision in the law which empowers or imposes that we have to comply with it, without which there is no seriousness about the need for issuing this particular form. So, as Mr. Srinivas was earlier telling, 195 subsection 6 is this particular provision which imposes or makes it a necessity that for any payment of any sum, when it is made to a non-resident, there is a need to issue Form 15CA. So that what it says is, it doesn't spell out the particular form in it. All it says is that the person referred to in subsection 1 shall furnish information relating to the payment of any such sum, whether or not chargeable under the provisions of the Act, in such form and manner as may be prescribed by the Board. So they have given delegated that power to the rules now. So they have just mentioned that in that form and manner as prescribed, the person who is required to make any payment of any sum to a non-resident has to furnish information, irrespective of whether there is any deduction of tax required or not, whether that income is chargeable to tax or not. Which means there may be some kind of payments where we take a stand that that particular amount which is being paid is not accruing in India, so there is no necessity to actually deduct tax because it's not income that India can actually tax. So in that cases also, in some situations they want to capture that information. So section 195 subsection 6, as I already mentioned, it is the person responsible for making the payment shall actually furnish those forms. So the rule which lays down how it has to be done is 37BB. So 37BB says that the information that has to be furnished under 195 subsection 6 shall be given in Form 15CA. So which is, the person who is making the payment shall have to give all that information that is called demanded by 195 subsection 6 in Form 15CA. And there is a certain aspect of what is the information that you need to be furnishing under Form 15CA also. Besides this, it also says that where a certificate has to be obtained from a chartered accountant, that particular form is Form 15CB. So what is exactly the latest rule, 37BB? So 37BB basically came into effect, the new rule as it stands today, came into effect in 2001, from 1st April 2016. I am not going to basically draw any comparisons or parallels to the earlier rule 37BB. I will dwell my discussion only on what is currently enforced. So, and this particular rule 37BB requires that we submit all these forms first electronically, and thereafter these forms have to be submitted in hard copies to the bankers, authorized dealers. So we have to submit this hard copy to the The form 15CB, we have to give it to our upload it and give the information. The client will actually take that and give a hard copy to the banker. And of course, our obligation to submit form 15CA, even in cases where there is no tax deduction at source, as I told you in 195 subsection 6, it requires that irrespective of whether there is any requirement to deduct tax or not, they want to capture this particular information. So it is necessary that we furnish form 15CA. So, Rule 37BB opens with saying that every person making a payment to a non-resident, that non-resident, it is uniform, the opening sentence is generally uniform. It says that any person making a payment to a non-resident, not being a company or to a foreign company. So, if that kind of payment is being made, and this particular payment, either that single payment or in aggregate together during the year, you are expecting that it is not likely to cover 5 lakh rupees, it is not going to exceed 5 lakh rupees, then the information should be furnished by the person who is making the payment in part A of form 15CA. So 15CA basically has 4 parts. First part is part A, part B, part C, part D. This is the way they have named these particular sections in the segments in 15CA. So part A is the first portion which requires only those payments which you don't expect to cross 5 lakhs in a particular year, either in a single payment or in aggregate, that information can be furnished there. Please note that it is not that these amounts which you are actually paying and disclosing under 15CA part A are not amounts which are actually exempt. They are actually also taxable. You may have to deduct tax. The only situation is that the amount is less than 5 lakhs. You don't expect the amount to cross 5 lakhs. So in this particular scenario is one situation wherein when a payment is made, it is sufficient if you furnish only form 15CA. There is no requirement for a chartered accountant certificate. One instance where chartered accountant certificate is not required, thus easing the process. As Mr. Srinivas was already mentioning that time, now there are many payments or many, almost 80% of the cases vis-a-vis earlier, before this new rule 37BB could be implemented, there was much more number of payments where you would give form 15CB. But now 15CB may not be required because the quantum of payment may not in all likelihood exceed 5 lakhs. The second portion, that is part B. So part B says that it covers all those payments which are in excess of 5 lakhs or those cases where you might have made applications under section 197 for subsection 1 for a lower deduction of the taxes, or under 195(2) where you are the receiver of the payment and then you have asked for the lower rate of deduction, or say under 195(3) where you feel that you are not, 195(3) is from the receiver where it says that he is not liable to pay tax, so he wants a nil rate of tax certificate, and 195(2) has already discussed, the person who is liable to make the payment could make an application also. So under these particular sections, if at all a person has approached the assessing officer and obtain those certificates, then those kind of payments need to be disclosed under part B. Then in part B you have to disclose the details of the assessing officer's order which he has given to you, or and mention that because of this particular reason you are charging a lower rate of tax. So this could be even in situations wherein the payment could be less than 5 lakhs, but for some reason there is an assessing officer order in relation to that payment, then it may have to be classified as under one night, disclosed under part B actually. Though not under part A, though it may not be under, the payment may not be exceeding 5 lakhs, but in spite of that, because there is an assessing officer reference, you may have to go here because you will be deducting tax at the lower rate. Because if you are not giving that reason as to why you are deducting the tax at a lower rate than that is applicable, you may be held liable for short deduction of the tax. So coming to part C. Part C is that portion where again the payments are in excess of 5 lakhs. The person making the payment to a non-resident is expecting that the payments are likely to exceed 5 lakhs, or there is a single payment in excess of 5 lakhs and this amount is again chargeable to tax in India, and you are required to deduct tax. This has to be supported by a chartered accountant certificate. So where you are obtaining chartered accountant certificate in form 15CB, you are going to disclose that particular information under part C of the form 15CA. So we find that form 15CB is required only in situations where the sum is chargeable to tax and it is exceeding 5 lakhs. Otherwise, we don't have an opportunity to even issue that certificate. The SSE can just disclose that information in Form 15CA, upload that information electronically, and thereafter furnish that as a hard copy to his authorized dealer.
In practical situations, as sir was telling, that where we are, even though if it is less than 5 lakhs and we obtained Form 15CB, at that point of time we have to use Part C only.
Part C you will have to use because you are giving a reference to that particular certificate. You have to link the data. Basically, it is mapping of data will be involved there as a practical scenario. So you will have to go for Part C in that situation. Maybe you will advise that there is no need to deduct tax or tax, whatever you might have advised in situations wherein. Part D, you are supposed to do it in, I come to Part D, but even before that, if that sum was not chargeable to tax also, but still you are supposed to give that itself. You will still certify saying that there is no tax to be deducted. So in spite of that, it will go into Part C there, in that scenario. Because otherwise you cannot issue that, you cannot satisfy the banker then.
In case of no deduction, Part D only you have to give.
Yeah, Part D you will have to give.
Yes, Form 15C, you cannot have 15C, Part C you cannot be in that case.
No, but if you are giving 15CB, if you are given it, you have to map it to 15C to consume that certificate.
Part D contents are not there in Part C. So it will be difficult for us to map that.
So, Part D is that portion of the Form 15CA where it is covering all those payments which are actually not chargeable to tax. So, this could be basically incomes which is actually not, I mean, the payment which is not.
Yes. See, this Part B, it has to be uploaded in the website. But there is no need for Form 15C. Only the banker will insist on 15C. So, you have to give 15C and 15C. You cannot link that, linking may not be required in case of Form Part D of Form 15C.
So, why was exactly when the sum itself is not chargeable to tax, why exactly were we required to furnish information in Part D? So there are situations wherein people used to take stand that this particular income is not accruing or arising in India, so I'm not deducting tax under this, and they just transfer that particular amount on the basis of 15CB. But what is happening is department was not able to capture this particular information. So it felt that there could be some kind of payments which would actually be liable to tax. But SSEs may be interpreting it wrongly and taking a stand that it is not liable to tax. So in order to capture that kind of information also and see if there is a scope for increasing the revenue from the perspective of the government, this Part D has been introduced so that you are able to even deliver that information to the department. So whichever cases where you are actually not deducting tax and making the payments on the ground that this is not income accruing or arising in India, those amounts you are going to basically disclose it in Part D. This is basically provided under 37BB sub rule 2. Then 37BB sub rule 3 talks of some more payments, which says that as an exception to even 37BB rule 2, it says that for these categories of payments you don't even have to give it in Part D. Which are those? So one is whenever an individual is making a payment to an overseas payment, and this is basically an approved payment under the FEMA Act, under the current account transactions rules. As an example of this could be the remittances through the liberalized remittance scheme. So when remittances are happening through the liberalized remittance scheme and this is made by an individual, since it is approved by the RBI, there is no need to actually disclose this information even in Part D. And besides this particular thing, there is one more exception where I have specified a certain list of payments here. About 33 kinds of payments, which is there in Rule 37BB, where in all these categories of payments, like it could be an example like a trial, maybe you are importing some goods, or you are making advance payments for some imports or goods, or you are making some personal donations and gifts. So these are the kind of situations, about 33 kind of categories, which RBI codes are there in that. So those categories also you don't have to disclose information under Part B also. So this is basically 37BB, which talks about what needs to go into Part A, what needs to go into Part B, what needs to be fulfilled in Part C and Part D, and where there is no necessity to bother about even issuing a 15CA. here. Part A, you are actually making it so that we are just consolidating our understanding. So part A is say, whether the remittance is chargeable to tax or not chargeable to tax. As I mentioned earlier, yes, whatever information is being disclosed under part A is definitely chargeable to tax. It's only that the remittance is not exceeding 5 lakhs and there is no need to give Form 15 CB in this particular case. Part B, again this amount is also chargeable to tax, but the only difference between vis-a-vis part A is that you may have a certificate, whether it exceeds 5 lakhs or does not exceed 5 lakhs, but you have obtained a certificate from an assessing officer for getting the benefit of lower deduction of taxes. So under such circumstances, you use part A and there is no requirement for furnishing, part B and there is no requirement for furnishing Form 15 CB in this instance also. Then coming to part C. Part C is again situations wherein the amount payable is more than 5 lakhs in a year or a single payment in excess of 5 lakhs and you are required to issue Form 15 CB here. And in the case of part D, there is no such limit on anything because in this particular case you are taking a stand for that the payment is not chargeable to tax itself. And here also there is no need to issue 15 CB. So besides that, the instructions to Form 15 CA, they clearly say that if at all you are a DAN holder, you need to furnish 15CA electronically only with a digital signature. And there may be situations wherein you are not actually holding a TAN, then you can upload this 15CA without using a digital signature. But in most instances, we need to have a, whenever you are making deducting taxes at source, you need to have a TAN, otherwise you will not be able to file your 27Q and close it. So effectively, I would say that you should use a digital signature for submitting even Form 15CA. And besides this, there is one new form that has actually come up, is Form 15CC. This is of course not relevant from the perspective of the payer or the recipient of money, but this is basically what the authorized dealer is required to furnish on a quarterly basis to the department. Again, this also is to be filed electronically. So just as a flowchart, you have to depict how 15CA operates. So first you have your remitter who wants to decide whether he has to obtain a certificate. So first thing you decide is whether you want to obtain a certificate from a CA in 15CB. Then you ask, go and access your website on Income Tax India e-filing. Then electronically you will upload your form 15CA, take a printout and then submit it to the banker there. So if your remitter submits this duly signed copies of 15CA and 15CB in duplicate to the banker, basically it's just a procedure which we have just been discussing all the while. Not much of a difference with what I have discussed till now. So coming to the nuances of Form 15CB. So why do we exactly need 15CB? 15CB is basically required to determine what is the exact nature of the tax that you are actually, nature of the service for which you are making the payment, the nature of payment rather. What is the nature of payment which you are making, whether it is royalties or fees for technical services or whether it is business payments or whether it is capital gains or any other form of payment which is liable to tax, either by virtue of DTAA, or first of all under income tax and then under DTAA. Then you have to determine the rate of tax that is basically applicable for that particular payment. So this is basically what is covered in the Form 15CB. So suppose we made a mistake in interpretation, something like that, can we be held liable in any manner? Basically 15CB is a recommendatory approach. We are only advising that this is our opinion about the particular payment based on the information that is being provided to us. So we are not, it's actually the final responsibility of the assessee to ensure that he has deducted the tax properly and remitted it to the government. So what exactly do we disclose in Form 15CB? In 15CB, we are basically disclosing the information relating to address, name and address and of the beneficiary, the country to which we are making this remittance, then whether we are, what is the amount in what and whether we are doing this gross remittance, TDS on crossing up basis or on the net payment. As we told about 195A earlier, sometimes we may be required to furnish pay tax on a crossing up basis because our supplier outside may not be, or the service provider outside may not be interested in bearing the tax burden of India, so which he has to fulfill in India. So in such a situation, we gross up and pay. That information also gets captured under 15CB. So then we also give the details of the banks through which we are making the remittance and the proposed date of remittance, the rate of TDS and the date when the tax was deducted at source and the remittance, nature of remittance. Yes, sir.
Exchange rate. It's become extremely difficult to get it from SBI, PT by day.
So basically we as a practice we are using RBI rates to the extent of those four currencies. If that is not possible, we are also going by other UNDA and X rates and all those cases itself. Because it's not always possible to get that from SBI. In fact, it has not been questioned or anything like that on that matter. Then also whether the remittance is net of taxes, as I told you, and the various payments, what is the nature of the remittance, whether it is royalties, fees for technical services, whether it is business income or capital gains, this is basically what is dealt by in 15 CB. Yes, ma'am. Well, see, you have to still analyze whether what is the nature, reason why you are paying it. So that is what, see, when there is a purchase transaction, if it is for goods, then there is no requirement. But again, if it is a services, then you it is again, you will have to see how the contract is structured. Whether it is.
This kind of
nature
of credit,
then I have to. Yeah, see, if it is business income or whatever it is, all these payments, if at all you are clear that the contract is not, it's in the nature of reimbursement of expenses, suppose you are able to substantiate that there is no income, it is just that payment, then there is no requirement. But if it is having this characteristic, like you are paying to the holding company, you are paying a royalty, or because you have deputed some people to this country, on secondment you are paying that reimbursement cost or anything, those kind of payments and all, where there is precedence also, judicial precedence also for that, where you may have to deduct TDS in all those cases.
Actually, generally,
inter
company, holding company, give the advances, maybe for this operation, this kind of plans will be there generally.
You mean to say Indian company is the holding company?
Yes.
And there is a subsidiary outside?
Yes.
Okay. So in all those situations, it's basically reimbursement of those cost of operation of that country.
Not it is not a reimbursement.
You will have to see in that
schedule. Give us an advance. We will show you the current account.
So you may have to see in that particular schedule of the specified list. I told you, there are 33 kinds of payments. If your payment fits into that specified list, wherein there are advances for operations overseas, that is one of the payment, that is one of the item of, which is given in the specified list. So if you fit into it, then there is no need. So you don't come under 15 CB in that category.
Sir, this
for
15 CB, you say here it's an opinion of a chartered accountant. So does that still amount to attestation?
Sir, because it says certificate of an accountant, 15 CB, because previously also the VAT and all, they are filling VAT audit, it's not a VAT audit, it's a certificate, so we are more on to that, this one. So whether that will be an opinion of an...
What he is trying to say is, what is the purpose of Form 15C? What is that we are certifying?
Correct.
That's the nature of remittance, the rate of taxes.
Correct.
So the next question is asking whether, what he is asking whether, if it's not a certificate, why it should, has to be certified? It's only an opinion. So that's actually a certificate, 15CB. But the question is asking whether the CA is responsible for that. If you ask, ultimately it's assessing is responsible for, means the person who is supposed to remit, he is responsible. But if he takes a certificate or opinion from a chartered accountant.
So technically it is still attestation?
It is.
No, it's not attestation, but we are certifying the nature of remittance and the rate of tax.
See, basically, based on the information, you have taken a stand and advised the claim. But again, if the claim wants to take a different stand or anything like that, we cannot be held responsible for any of those things. It is basically our what information he furnishes, based on that, you would have taken a conclusion. That you would have drawn a conclusion.
But if I am giving the information on 15 CB, which again is online, and he has to just pull it
now
out of 15 CB.
That is right. Now, because of that arrangement, now there is no scope for deviating.
It has to be based on whatever
the right. There is no scope for deviating from it. Now, because the information just pulled, gets pulled up from the 15 CB.
But based on my opinion, say, suppose if I am giving a certificate for capital gains, I cannot calculate, even though I know that that entire amount is not subject to taxation, I cannot calculate and give certificate only for that particular portion of income. On the gross payments, I have to give a certificate. So there I cannot use my intelligence and say that this is not subject to taxation, I will give certificate only for this. That will be a problem. And unless you get a order from the assessing officer or a certificate for withholding for that portion or less rate of tax, usually we should not do that.
So So coming to the process of how do we actually prepare a form 15CB online. So
even though 15CB is uploaded, it's on the basis of SSE's missing reliance. 15C is information, 15CB has to attach with that 15CA. So it's up to him whether to rely on this or not. Ultimately, SSE has to rely on the certificate given by the chartered accountant.
So in order to find the 15CA, the first step that we should request our client is that they should add us as a CA, just as we do it for tax audits and all that. So the client has to actually first, through his login on the portal, he has to add us as a CA and allow us to say that this particular CA is being added for issuing a form 15CB. Thereafter only we will be able to actually generate a form 15CB for the particular client. So of course this is all that various micro level steps which we may not be familiar with already. So in order to find the 15CB, we as chartered accountants, what we need to do, so we will definitely have our own CA login there, wherein we, it's not a regular income tax filing login, we definitely are using another login as a chartered accountant. Through that login, we will basically go in, get into the system of the income tax portal and enter all those details for filling up the form 15CB. We go to the e-filing there, we have a list of forms there. It clearly says whether you want to file form 15CB in bulk or any other income tax forms. In that income tax forms, if you go to the drop down list there, once you log in through your CA login, you get a list where you can, as 15CB is one of the line items. In that, you can basically, if you want to just upload one form 15CB, you can select that. But even before that, what you can do is before login also, first you can go to the download links on the home page of income tax e-filing portal, download that utility there. That utility permits you to enter all this, prepare the 15CB offline. So the unique feature of this utility is that you can prepare multiple 15CBs and save it as XML files. So once you have saved it in XML files, you can just log into the portal and then through your CA login, you can upload either in bulk by creating a zipped folder, or individually you can upload it through the drop-down menu under e-filing, where you select other income tax forms and file it. So this is basically the gist of the submission of 15CB. So 15CB has to be mandatorily submitted using your digital signature, there is no option. So you need to first create the DSE file, utility file, attach this, map this particular zipped file or this XML file with the digital signature and create a signature file when you are uploading it. Thereafter, when you go to the submit screen, you will be allowed to first upload the XML file first, and thereafter you will have to attach your digital signature file and upload it. So the basic information that, as I earlier mentioned, 15CB is containing is also about the remitter bank and all those things. You should, if at all any of these portions are not filled up properly offline, the utility is very well structured to point out this errors through validation, and you can simply identify that and direct you to the cell where that particular error is existing. You can rectify it and validate the file, then generate the XML and upload it. So in 15CB, now the one thing which we can remember is that bulk upload is possible. This is basically just a screenshot of how when you are uploading the 15CB, how it appears. And then once you have submitted the form 15CB successfully, there is a email that triggers to both the chartered accountant as well as his client, saying that this particular 15CB has been uploaded. So having uploaded the form 15CB for both corporate and non-corporate SSE, they can view this particular 15CB which would have uploaded by their through their income tax login. So they will have to just go to work list on the menu there. Once they log into their income tax site, there is a tab called work list at the top, so they can click on that and see further action. Then the list of 15CBs that have been uploaded appears there. So they can click on view form and view this particular 15CB. So once they have they prepare a 15CA, and this 15CA is they linked it to this 15CB, then the status of this 15CB changes to consumed. Until then, 15CB remains in submitted form. So once it gets mapped to the 15CA, then the status changes to consumed. So 15 CA can be actually, once you file a 15 CA, you can actually withdraw that 15 CA within 7 days. So this 15 CB, we have made a mistake connecting, we don't have an option to withdraw it or correct it or anything. So we may have to, suppose we come across this and we want to change the 15 CB, we may have to approach the client to tell him, okay, upload the 15 CA, map it, and then withdraw the 15 CA so that this particular 15 CB gets rejected, so that you can make any corrections to it. There is no direct way in which we can actually go and make any correction to form 15 CB. So here, I would just like to just throw a few questions on Form 15 CB. What kind of issues we may have, which I could think of. Of course, if you have faced any situations in 15 CB, please feel free to just share it with us so that it is collective learning. So one question I would like to pose here is that there are multiple invoices for a single claim, and I have received it on different dates. The characteristic of the payment is the same. It is royalties, for example. Let us take it as royalties. Can I just issue one Form 15 CB here? Is it possible or not possible to issue 115 CB? No, it is basically, let us forget about the fee part of it right now.
Technically, yes.
You said that we are issuing a certificate, but based on the assessee's information. Yeah. I am not sure about the section 271J or something. Any wrong certification by a chartered accountant will result in a serious penalty, and I don't know whether cross count is also there. So will we get into such a situation, sir?
No. Seeing not just based on the information, definitely we have to apply our mind and we have to give. What I said is, you have to certify the nature of rental and rate of tax, which has to be related by the SSE. I am not saying this based on, of course, based on the information verification only will give, but we certify these two things. Under 15 CB, we certify the nature of remittance and the rate of tax.
You have to identify it correctly, and correct. Also the rate of tax also should be correct.
Correct.
And after you image the payment, you will give the certificate.
Not after we image the payment, after I give the certificate only, you will
make the payment.
So for this particular question,
answers for this question.
What is the consensus? Whether it should be issued on multiple 15 CBs or
115 CBs?
115 CBs is sufficient. As long as the nature of payment is same, even though invoices is of different dates.
If I form 15 CB, like it says the date of deduction. So you cannot have different dates of deduction in one certificate.
Even
so you cannot give one certificate here, you have to give multiple certificates.
Because date of deduction becomes relevant here. So if a date of deduction is going to be on different dates, because invoices are dated differently, then what happens is you have to issue multiple forms.
You don't do tax planning for your client and say, I put one date of deduction for a particular month, and you will be losing your whatever 5,000 or 2,500, whatever you are charging, you will be losing.
So, next question I would like to pose to
you. If the invoices are accounted on the same day due to the.
It is accounted on the same day.
Next question, if you see, there is multiple invoices issued on the same day. Whether one certificate is issued or can be issued for
no, different dates invoices. Invoices are dated different dates, but I have accounted once because
that's what you are using your intelligence for losing your revenue.
But it is not practical
actually. I am on the other side.
No, whichever depends upon how you are accounting. If you are doing that is your system, it's okay, sir. Otherwise you let us not do any tax planning for the you cannot issue certificate also.
What if
Sir,
what if
the
number of invoices were quite large?
You have to keep 100 certificates, sir. 100 or 200 certificates also per month you have to issue.
Good amount, sir.
So, for the second question, obviously the answer is yes, you can issue one certificate because it is all the data of deduction is uniform across all of them. And the nature of payment is uniform. Not funds that go on.
You are saying other side, but here because of this multinational companies, accounting will be done somewhere else. You cannot say for income tax purpose you do book everything on Monday. Like in India, billing will be done in maybe Philippines or China or USA. So they cannot wait till the month end to do the invoice. So there, I think it's not feasible to do like that.
Yes.
Yeah,
so the third question to you are, is invoices contain multiple natures of nature of income. Whether 15 CV to be issued for each nature of income separately. There is a single invoice, but you have multiple line items. There is one of the payment could be for royalties, another payment could be for some other services. It could be some interest payment or whatever, some commission or whatever. So in this situation, can you accommodate this in 115 CV or for, it should be split into 250 CVs and issued? So, since the nature of income, the payment, nature of payment is what is important in when they are issuing 15 CD. One of the, in 15 CD, one usual drop down is the nature of payment, whether it is a sponsorship fee or a business or a capital gain, what it has. So, you need to definitely, you can't accommodate the design of 15 CD such that you can't accommodate multiple natures of payment. So, you have to split the invoice and issue two. Then invoice contains taxable as well as non-taxable income. Whether 15 CV to be issued separately. So you basically, when in the same situation earlier, you can give one nature of payment only in the in 15 CV, which is taxable. So you will cover your 15 CV for the taxable thing. He has to split the 15 CA when he is doing. For 15 CA for the one which is taxable, he is going to give one portion. Another 15 CA party is going to fill up for the remaining portion, though it is one and the same invoice. So this is, we have just dealt with 15 CB till now. 15 CA also, let us just quickly look at what exactly do we need to do to prepare 15 CA online. So first of all, the person who needs to generate 15 CA needs to have a span and plan for this particular. And then if at all it's not, you know the registration process on the income tax portal. You can register and get the login created. So then, now, prior to I think 2016, I think there was a bulk option which I had for even 15 CA. But right now I don't see this bulk option being available. Correct me if I am wrong, but my understanding is that for 15 CA there is no bulk filing option because we need to do a mapping of 1 to 1, 15 CB and 15 CA. So there is no bulk option available at least in 15 CA now. So you need to generate 15 CA each time you are making a separate payment. And so that is, since there is no bulk option, there is no XML version, you have to do it on the web-based filling up only here. So first, for even this 15 CA, once you log in, you can go into the e-file tab, and then you select the income tax forms, and in that income tax form, you are going to select your form 15 CA. Once you select 15 CA, it opens up and asks you first thing whether you want to fill part A, or part B, or part C, or part D. So you make a choice of which one you basically would want to select, depending on the type of payment which you are making. So once you, of course, as I told you, the 15 CA information also is divided. For part A, it is a very little information. It asks you only about the remitter, remittee, and the rate of tax and the nature of payment and date of deduction, those aspects. So when you go to part B, one additional information that it asks you is the assessing officer's order details is what it's going to ask you. So when it comes to part C, besides the remitter, remittance, bank details, and all those basic information which is common in part A and part B, it asks you for the chartered accountant certificates acknowledgement number. But the moment you select part C, the first thing that it asks you is 15 series acknowledgement number. So once you put that, then only you go to the next screen, wherein you can fill up section 2 of the part C there. And you once you compile this, here also it has the same feature wherein you submit the information. First you do a preview and submit. If there are no errors, then the validation gets completed. And then it allows you to submit further. So when you are submitting it, it takes you to a screen where you need to attach your digital signature. You need to map it, create the DSC file, signature file, and attach it and upload form 15 CA. So I think basically, I was planning to even cover 206 AA, but since 206 AA has already been discussed, I would not want to get into 206 AA and Rule 37 BC. Which was already dealt with by Mr. Srinivas. I think with this I am open to any other questions or any other problems which you have encountered in this particular process of preparing 15 CA and 15 CB. And just one minute, I would like to just point out that there are some errors in the slides, the printout which you are having. Because these slides, yeah, I just did some updates and I am using these slides. There are some printouts there are not having the updated information. I just apologize for that when it was shared. I think it was a wrong file that got attached and we sent it.
We uploaded in the Institute website.
Yeah, you can upload it on the Institute website.
Bangalore branch website it will be uploaded.
Sir, in case of transfer of amount from NRO account to NRA account, in CS.
Sir, because it is again a movement out of the country. It is like a overseas remittance movement when you are doing it. We need to actually 15 CD, but on that payment is exceeding that particular 5 lakhs limit, and we may have to give this 15 CP when you are transferring money from NRO to NRE account. Though you may cite that saying that this is actually, and this again from the banker's perspective only most of the time. Strictly speaking, the NRO amount which is there in NRO account will be tax deferred income, that is clear. It is only from this pocket to the other pocket you are shifting, logically speaking. So, from 15 CP is actually not required. But since in a practical scenario, some banks don't understand that, we will be required to give 15 CP.
Also, actually, we need to mention all that currency transfer which country and all we need to mention.
No?
There, where is the option that
transfer from? That is a challenge. Because this particular situation, you cannot do that instance there. So, we may have to just give this details of this NRO account itself and the residence of that particular. Maybe Mr. Srinivas can just add some light into this. His question is that when I am transferring money from the NRO to NRA account, people are asking for 15 CB. Yeah. So, in this example, when I give 15 CB, how do I fill up the overseas bank details and all? My opinion, you have to fill up whatever is the NRA details only and fill it.
There is specifically as that foreign currency you need to mention in dollars.
Whichever the currency which you have got.
In NRA account, it is in Indian rupees.
It is in Indian rupees, but you are remitting it in which currency? You are converting it to which currency you are mentioning?
In NRA account, normally Indian.
That is in Indian rupees. See, every time the money goes from an Indian bank account only to the overseas bank account, you convert it to
the currency. This is NRO to NRE.
NRO.
NRO to NRE. Both in the same bank.
Both in the same
bank. NRO to NRE account. If you are remitting in Indian rupee, you say Indian currency is not an issue. Not an issue. There may be payments, overseas payments in Indian rupees also.
Then whether we need to mention it is an exempted.
Yeah, those things you have to mention. See, actually there is no need for certificate because bankers are existing, you have to do that.
So part D is enough for it.
Yeah.
Sir, there will not be any problem because NRO interest rate tax only in the 30%. NRE account is the interest rate tax.
NRO interest is exempted, sir.
NRE
is exempted.
In that case, he transferred the money from NRO to NRE. Then automatically
that should not be. No. Yeah, NRE to
NRO or Ulta. NRO to NRE.
Okay. See, whatever amount is there in NRO, already it has been tax suffered amount, no? Tax suffered amount. Now it's only you are moving from your one account to another account. So for that transaction there is no taxation.
Whatever goes into NRE is basically tax suffered income is the assumption generally. That is my own money which I am moving from one account to another.
Even if you are transferring from your Indian account to your account in abroad, there also there is no tax element in that. So whatever taxes that has been that is supposed to be paid would have already paid in India.
Even if some of those transactions, like the NRA is transferring it for his living expenses abroad from his Indian account there, that comes under the specified list of those 33 transactions when you see it. So there it is not necessary actually.
If a non-resident is working in India and he gets a salary income, TDS would have been done in the system 192. If he is transferring that amount to his overseas account, there is no need for TDS.
Any payments to Nepal is also subject to this 15 CA, 15 CB.
I think 15 CB for Nepal you don't have
15 CB. No, there is no exemption for any country assets.
Sir, for deduction of tax.
Maybe for going even you need not require visa, but I don't think for payment there is an exemption.
So when we derive the tax for any non-resident payments, you have to file return.
You mean to say the non-resident,
for non-resident payments, 27.
Yeah, 27Q has to be filed.
Now we don't have the PAN number of the parties.
See, one thing is if you see that 206A, subsection 7, the four categories of payments, royalties, interest, capital gains.
Let's assume it's royalty.
Yeah, so royalties under 206A, if at all you have collected the information.
So I have the
like address, name,
yes,
email,
we have
tax residency certificate, these documents if you have basically collected, then you don't you are exempt from the non-resident need not give you a PAN.
Right. So will I get some form 16 or something which I can give to the party?
See, if you form 16, my understanding is that there is no such requirement or anything that calls for you to issue a form 16 here.
No, but then how will the foreign party claim a foreign tax credit for the deduction of
tax? If at all he is having a PAN number and he is filing,
no, he does not have.
Then he will not even for foreign tax credit is what
yes.
Talking about.
Yes.
Then he has to claim a foreign
right.
tax credit. So then, sir, can you just throw some light on
here? There is a practical issue.
27Q.
I am filing 27Q. I don't have the PAN because a non-resident will never.
He will not generate 16 years.
Then how will he claim the tax credit?
He cannot.
It's
sir,
a
the 16 is not coming.
Mr. Krishna, to the session on foreign tax credits, did he mention anything about this?
I didn't ask.
No, but now after that amendment in Rule 37BC, where PAN is not mandatory.
No, even then, sir, see, we are not talking about whether PAN requirement is there or not. I am talking about a practical issue where I am deducting tax from his payment.
Correct.
He is saying, give me something based on which I will
do. No, but usually we used to give Form 16A in a word, we used to prepare and we used to send.
So that is valid?
No, I don't know.
Sir, now, technically, sir.
Because in 26 years, that will not come.
No,
it will not come. If you open in India 26 years for the non-resident, it will not come. But he can use it in his country for claiming foreign tax credit, I'm not aware.
Sir, technically, sir, for in the Form 16A, this one, there it says that any person deducting a tax has to issue Form 16. It doesn't say any person deducting a tax having PAN number has to issue there.
Correct.
So,
now Form 16 and 16A is generated through that
traces.
Correct.
Traces.
I agree, sir. So, in cases of PAN only, it is generating through traces. But if it is not having a PAN, then it is on the responsibility of myself, because to say I have to, Form 16 has to be issued based
that's
on
what I'm saying. That's what I'm saying through in the word that same format you give the thing. But when once he wants to file his economic income, he should have a PAN in India. In the foreign country, if they allow based on that certificate, foreign tax credit, it's okay. Otherwise, it will be a problem. He has to obtain a PAN.
So one more question. Different way to this. I am a resident and I am buying a property from somebody. At point of buying, I am not aware. At a later point of time, I came to know that he is a non-resident, right? Now, technically, when it's a resident to resident, 194I will come. But when it is a resident to, non-resident to,
resident to non-resident,
195 will come. But I have already deducted tax under 194I. So what is the solution? Or is there a solution?
If you can actually substantiate that at the time you deducted the tax, you had relied upon information where you had reason to believe that it is a resident to resident payment, you have a defense. Otherwise, you are an assessing.
In one of the practical case for non-resident, 194 IA was done, that is 1% was done. Subsequently, we told him to do what? 20.6%.
So,
but
subsequently, we said 20.6% you have to do. They deducted 20.6%. Both were there. 194 IA was also there. 20.6% also was there. Because he had a PAN and he was filing return of income, we filed his return of income. Whatever excess, we claimed the refund.
But now, sir, mandated that resident paid the full payment to the non-resident.
You are assessing in default, sir.
Assessing in default, that's
he
cannot avoid.
He is a resident, he has purchased now.
Yeah, so I am in default.
Now, what is the solution, sir, for this?
No solution, sir. If you get a notice, you have to pay interest penalty also.
So I can't take recourse under the, of course you said it.
Especially chartered accountant cannot say I don't know the law.
No, I know. So I am saying, can I still?
No, that's what sir. For non-payments on this end, assessing default is still under assessing default.
You must be in at least position to some reliance. If at all you have to argue, you should have sound information.
Most of the cases,
most
of the cases, what happens, we will never ask whether that person is a resident or non-resident. Because he will give a local, he will have a PAN, He will have Aadhaar also, he will give a local bank account
bank
also.
Account also is local.
But we will never ask where are you from. Maybe you would have come from abroad also. Maybe your friend's cousin, the friend's brother, all those things. We always tend to see him as an Indian. This 60 days, 190 days, even we will not apply. For our own case, we will not apply. Even when once a client comes also, we will not apply our mind whether he is a resident or non-resident. So in these cases, it's better we should apply our mind. Because even though he is his brother or relative or who was in India for almost 25 years, now he has gone and come back to sell his property, he should be very careful in those cases. At least you should ask for last 2-3 years his return there, as what he has filed, where he is staying. Because everything he will give, Indian this PAN number he will give, Aadhaar also he will give, Indian bank account also he will give. He will not give passport, excluding that everything he will give. We should be careful while doing the transaction or advising our client.
Maybe in the agreement or something, you should take a confirmation that he is a resident or a non-resident. Explicitly, like if he has given it as a resident, you can at least rely on that
time. At least whether he is filing the return of income, one or two about, no. When you ask, no. Like they will say he is a non-resident, something at least will come out. Otherwise, you will not.
Sir, why filing at 26 TV, the system should then non-resident
Pan Nagar
will put, that should
say
that
it is
a non-resident.
How will it change? Every year it will change, no? We cannot have separate PAN for resident and non-resident.
If it's a company, yes, we can say it's a resident. If it's an individual, it's difficult.
No, even then it's difficult. No,
my question was, then the PAN number is already registered as a non-resident.
No, need not be.
Where is
it? No, he was a non-resident last year.
Yes, sir. Now there is a different form for obtaining a PAN. 49A, 49AA for non-resident. Earlier it was not there. 49A, I used to apply for everybody, whether resident or non-resident, I would have got it. There is no column in 49A also to say whether he is a resident or non-resident. I don't remember that. Of late I have not filled it. Only 49AA, it's a separate form for non-resident to obtain a PAN. Earlier I don't think, he will give Indian address also.
This reimbursement of expenses from resident to non-resident, so in which clause it is covered?
Reimbursement of expenses from resident to non-resident. I think it is, when you read that particular 37th schedule of
January, we are also planning on ARRC and international taxation in Bangalore. So I request all of you to participate. Few people have given the comments. Of course, most of the comments for the yesterday's last speaker, Prashant, everybody has said the presentation was good and we had a lot of contents, but maybe it was fast or he was insisting more on the case laws. Of course, I will convey it to you. But otherwise, overall, all the speakers have given a good feedback. Definitely, we will see where we have to improve. I think one person has given about like food and all, segregating wet waste and dry waste. I don't know whether she is here. Rowena Nobo. She is here. She has left out. This I will give to the secretary to implement whatever possible from the branch. Thank you for the feedback. And few people asked for the PPT. As I said, everything will be uploaded.
So, let us thank the speakers for the yesterday, C.A. Vivek Dhawan, C.A. Narendra Jain, C.A. Vishnu Babaji, C.A. Prashant D.S. and today's speakers, C.A. Sachin Kumar V.P., C.A. Krishnan S. and C.A. Rashi and C.A. Vinay Sethi, last but not the least, the coordinator of the program, who has invited to chair out this program, C.A. Kothaya Srinivas. I request all the members to give the applause to the Kothaya Srinivas. Members, as we are on July 1st, we are celebrating 70th CA day. We are arranged for the blood donation camp and activities for the members, cultural activities. I request you all to participate. I thank you all for your active participation in the 2 days seminar on international taxation. I wish you all happy in advance CA day.